Good morning. Let's join our voices together in our call to worship. We gather together in the name of Jesus Christ. Members of God's family, brothers and sisters, among one. For we have been brought together by the redeeming love of Jesus. Let's join together in worship.
Let's pray together. Holy and gracious Father, we come into your presence with grateful hearts, grateful to be able to call you our Father and to know that you call us a child of God. We give you thanks. We realize that we have been adopted into the family, and it's all because of Christ Jesus our Lord. Lord, we give you praise and thanks, and we lift up today the fathers in this place and fathers in our church who set an example to live for Christ and to give him the glory in everything they do in their lives. We have members, Lord, that are in Mexico and staff that are on a mission trip, and we lift them up and we pray for their protection and for their fruitfulness in their mission work this week. And Lord, we lift up our church to you. We pray on this Father's Day, Lord, for your Holy Spirit to give us guidance, to give us unity, and unity in following you, your will, and your ways. Lord, as we worship together today, we pray for the Holy Spirit to come and fill the worshipers so that we might worship, truly worship in spirit and in truth. To the glory of your name, let the church say amen.
Amen. Good morning. Happy Father's Day.
Good morning.
It is great to see you all today, and it's really a special day for me. For Terry and I, we are so thankful that our son and his fiancée, Alex, and our daughter, Chelsea, and her fiancée, Matthew, and Callie, who is only 15 and better not have a fiancée, they are all here in one pew today, so it's a great gift for me to have all of our children in worship with us today. And I know Terry and I both feel the same way. It is wonderful to see you in worship, and we're going to start as we begin together by singing 545, The Church's One Foundation is Jesus Christ, Her Lord. Let's stand, we'll sing together.
The church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought. Elect from
of faith, which is the Apostles' Creed. Let us now join together in this historic confession of the Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Seated. Good morning. A couple of announcements. As you're filling out your Connect card and if you're worshiping online, please fill that out and let us know how we can pray for you when you fill out your card and turn that in. There's a blood mobile on 27th Street. If you're able to give blood today, we have a blood drive. And this week we've had about 75 people living in our church building. From over in the Golden Triangle area in Houston. Some of them were from the church I pastored in Lumberton, so that youth group was here. And they lived in our church facilities, and they are grateful and thankful for our hospitality. And they left us with this. This is all we get for the whole week right here. And we get the knowledge of knowing that they went out into our community. UM Army went out to about 20 homes, and they repaired those homes for people that are low-income and elderly, and they did a lot of work. And on Thursday night, there was a worship service with those people that we helped. It was here. I preached and served communion to the UM Army and our group, and we were very, very blessed this week. And we turn around and do it again this week. We're hosting on Thursday and Friday the youth group from Faith United Methodist Church in Richmond, Texas, where they're going to actually come here and work on our campus, and they're going to paint the playground fence and the lampposts, and they're going to enjoy 105-degree weather. So hopefully they will have wisdom to drink a lot of high-quality H2O. Today is the day that our Staff Parish Relations Committee has set aside to honor a staff person who's been working for us for 20 years. And we are grateful. He grew up and this is his life. Jeff Hobbs, we have a video to show, and this is Jeff's ministry for 20 years. I'm grateful for Jill for all the background pictures and Leanne. And so, Cameron, go ahead and show Jeff's ministry here for 20 years. All condensed in 4 minutes, Jeff.
Jeffrey, you are the reason why I'm a children's director. I thought that it was going to be youth ministry. Nah, you are the mentor that let me fly 10 years ago. Your love for your children and family is just so vast, and I learned from the best of the best. I love you like a brother.
I don't mind if you got something nice to say about me. I enjoy an accolade like the rest. You could take my picture and hang it in a gallery of all the who's who's. such and such, it wouldn't matter much.
This is the third time he's had to endure this. I know. And I want to thank Jill, your wife, for helping us. The Lord truly blessed you. And you and Jill work together, and we're grateful. So grateful. Thank you, Jill. Y'all should applaud for Jill, believe me. Amen. So, a couple things you haven't seen yet. We asked Representative John Rainey to have a resolution drawn up to honor you. So I have that resolution. You can frame it. And I'm just going to read a little part of it to the end. Resolved. Jeff Hobbs be commended for his outstanding 20-year tenure as Director of Children and Family Ministries at First United Methodist Church Bryan, and that he be extended sincere best wishes for continued success in his important work. Amen. And we'll give this to you. Tony Fazzino wanted you to have something you'll never forget. So Tony took time away from flying an airplane to create always our champion ping pong paddle. Yes. And Tony wants you to know he's going to take his title back, by the way. In this basket are a lot of gift cards, written from the heart, but also some gifts that the church Sunday school classes and members wanted to give to you, and I'm probably best to hand it off to Jill right now, and because you have more work to do, but before you work even more than you do, I'm glad we ended the video. Leanne ended the video with you running, and that's truth, because you're running all the time. There's so much to do. You do so much more than just children's and ministry and family. You're such a blessing to the whole staff, help train many, and a blessing to me. Next week, again, you're preaching for me while I'm gone, and I'm grateful for that because you do an excellent job preaching. And who knows if the Lord will not call you one day. I know that's always where the Holy Spirit would whisper to us, because you certainly have the gifts and graces, and you have been a blessing and will be a blessing. I hope you serve 20, 30 years more till you drop. Okay. Amen. Everybody give Jeff some thanks today, okay?
Special time. While they're coming forward, I want to invite y'all to stand and welcome one another to worship.
Hey. You bet. Thanks. We gave him.
Enjoyed doing this 20 years, and only a few of us have been here for 20 years, right? You have not. Okay, Rebecca is giving everyone a cotton ball, not in the way I expected her to, but that's one way to do it, but that's what we're going to be doing anyway. So, does everybody have one? Okay, I want you all to, did you get one? I want you to stand up and go over there to the carpet. All right. Are you going to do it too?
What is it?
Come on. Well, I'm not going to tell you that. Come on. All right. So what I like to do every now and then is hone my ping pong skills. And one of those things is hand-eye coordination. So what I like to do every now and then is throw cotton balls into a target, right? So here's what I'm going to be throwing it into. Y'all think y'all could do that? Okay. Oh, we need more cotton. Levi needs cotton here. Okay. Well, we got plenty. All right. So I'm going to be aiming for the bowl, and y'all are going to be aiming for this communion cup right here. Seriously. Okay. But if you make it into the bowl, I get the point. Okay, ready? All right, when you're ready, you throw. Now, there's been kids that were closer. Throw it, Levi. Start throwing, everyone. Go ahead. Close. You don't think anyone's going to... Very close.
Rebecca? Oh, she misses. Everybody throw. Now, oh, and she missed. That's what happens. Okay. Look at there. See, Pastor Rick, they learned so fast. Okay, everybody scoot back for a second. Scoot back. Wouldn't you know? All right, hold on, Will. Go ahead, Will. Let me take Natalie's that she stuffed in here. Go ahead, Will. All right. Go ahead, Reese. You're taking yours for dinner? Go, one last try, Reese. Go for it. Okay, so the children that threw theirs, all right, have a seat. The children that threw theirs missed. Even the children that tried to get real close ended up missing. But let's say that if you were right next to that cup, you should be able to make it, shouldn't you? Pretty close. Look at that. Thank you. Now, if I were to sit here, will I ever miss? Sometimes maybe. It might bounce off, right? But the closer I am, the more likely I am to get it in, right? Now, what if I'm aiming for this cup and I do this? Why would I do that? Why would I throw the opposite? Wouldn't that be weird in basketball if the team's goal is this way and someone on that team trying to go that way shoots it in the other goal? That would be so weird. Well, what I want to talk about today is sin, and the definition of sin is to miss the mark. Like if you're shooting a bow and arrow and you miss the target, it's called sin. Yes, ma'am. In the wrong goal. Yeah, Adam does that all the time. So today during Sunday school, we were talking about, so I was going to say that one person was a sinner, and I said, you know what? When there's someone that's a sinner, our Christian brothers and sinners. I said sinners instead of sisters, and the girls got real upset with me. But so if we are aiming at something. God gave us something to aim at, and it's a target, and it's Jesus. Now, why is our target so small? Because Jesus is not like anything in this world. It's not easy to follow Jesus, but the closer we are, the easier it is to hit the target. If we're far away from Jesus, we're going to miss living the way he wants us to live. But the closer we are to him, if we sit at his feet, the easier it is to hit the mark, to hit the target. Now, sometimes even when we're close, we may still miss a little bit. But the further we are away from his word and his feet, the further we are going to be from hitting the target. That is why we've got to be in his word and sitting at the feet of Jesus. And it doesn't matter. Like, even some of the worst sinners in the Bible, they knew that if they sat at the feet of Jesus, they were doing the right thing. Okay? So we all sin and fall short of the glory of God, but thanks be to God that we have grace through Jesus Christ that we can sit at his feet. All right, my verse comes from Hebrews chapter 10, verse 22, and it says, "Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that brings faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water." Before we pray, I want to say one thing about being here with you. It is the joy of my life to be here with you every week and to see you grow. This morning at 8:30, I had some of my kids that they're in high school, some of them out of high school. It is truly my joy to see you grow, and I want to encourage you to be as close to Jesus Christ as you grow. Let's bow our heads and pray. Dear God, guide us as we come closer to you. May we forever sit at the feet of Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
let me say to you that from a personal aspect, I get the opportunity most Tuesday mornings to sit next to Jeff Hobbs in staff meeting. And I have to tell you, we have a great time because we laugh and cut up a lot. But the thing that I want to share with you that really means a lot to me, when I came here 4 years ago, David Henry had been minister of music here 18 years and was very well loved in the church, and it was big shoes to fill. David and I had been friends a long time, but in coming, it was rather daunting. And I don't know whether you remember this, Jeff, or not, but one day after I'd been here a while, Jeff said to me, "You know, when David left, I was really worried about how things would go. But you've done a great job, and I'm glad you're here." I needed to hear that desperately, and I appreciate it so much. Jeff is not just a friend to our kids. He's a friend to all of us, and it's great to work with him. And Jeff, happy 20th. Thank you for all you do for all of us, really. For all of us adults, too. And just so you'll know, Steph Parrish came to me and said, "You know, we visited with Jill a little bit to find out what Jeff's favorite hymns were. And we decided we were going to sing those to the glory of God and in honor of Jeff today. Now, it looks a little odd when you sing Rock of Ages and Christ the Lord is Risen Today together with How Great Thou Art in the middle. And we normally don't sing Christ the Lord is Risen Today except on Easter. But remember, every day is Easter Day from now on, and we can sing Christ the Lord is Risen Today any Sunday of the year. So in honor of Jeff, we're going to sing these hymns, Rock of Ages, How Great Thou Art, and Christ the Lord is Risen Today. Will you stand? Let's sing together.
our thanks and praise for all that you have done for us. We thank you for your creation and the beauty of your world. And we thank you for the blessing of family and friends and for their loving care which continues to surround us. We thank you for giving us tasks which demand our best efforts and leading us to accomplish that which glorifies you alone. We also thank you for those disappointments and failures that will lead us to acknowledge our dependence on you alone. Grant us the gift of your Spirit, that we may know him and make him known, and through him at all times and in all places may give thanks to you in all things. We pray that we may honor you with these gifts and glorify you in all that we do. In the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Thank you.
Cameron, do me a favor. You've got a picture of our group in the parking lot from Saturday, right before they went to Mexico. We prayed. Thank you. I want you to remember all of our church members and staff that are in Mexico this week. Keep them in your prayers. Every day they're doing hard work, and they're trying to witness for Jesus as well. And I just want you to see that picture. And so grateful that the Lord has provided for them and for this trip. I want to thank those of you who financially helped. You went to a lot of lunch fundraisers, but you also gave generously in other ways. So thank you. I'm looking forward to what Pastor Jen and the group will share when they get back. I'm going to read from Ephesians chapter 2 today, and Cameron, I'm skipping down to verse 18. So I'm going straight to the heart of the passage. And this is one of my favorite passages in the New Testament, because there are two verses here, two out of five I'm going to read, that explicitly state the Trinity. You rarely see that in the New Testament, but there are two verses here. And since last Sunday was Trinity Sunday, we didn't really mention it, thought it'd be good to mention as I read this. Hear the word of the Lord, verse 18. For through him, that is Jesus, we both have access in one Spirit, the Holy Spirit, to the Father. So there's the Trinity. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens. That's going to be my key word today, aliens. But you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure being joined together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. Verse 22 also has all three members of the Trinity. In him, that is Jesus, you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God the Father by the Spirit. Lord, I pray that as your word is preached, you will feed your sheep so that they will not go away from here hungry. Let's help hungry to do your will. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. So happy Father's Day to all of you, and the Lord be praised for godly men who love their wives like Christ loves the church. That's our calling. And raise their family in the faith. I realize raising kids is a tough job. I've raised three. I have three grandchildren, one on the way. And I got to tell you, I know that sometimes our kids think that their parents are aliens from another planet. Yes, kids, believe me, your parents think you are aliens from another planet sometimes. I read this week an amazing survey that I could not believe, but it is an indicator of the times we live in. They surveyed people in America and found that 65% believe in aliens from another planet. 65%. That's almost as many as say they believe in Christ Jesus. They did a worldwide survey 4 years ago, and they found out that around the world, 47% of the people believe in intelligent alien life, which tells me none of them understand the Dallas Cowboy football team at all. But when you think about that, that means half of the people seriously, seriously take a sign in Roswell, New Mexico that I drove by last year seriously. Alien crossing. It's really shocking to me how much this has gone up. And I realize that people can disagree, but I've never seen an alien. However, 12 years ago, I did move here, and you may not have seen a picture of me outside the sanctuary when I first moved here. Could you show that for me, Cameron? Yes. And I want to thank Jeff for his artistic work. He is the best. That dog, by the way, is an alien dog, because as we know, all dogs are aliens. Cats will tell you that, believe me. I want to focus on this word alien in this passage. That's my main focus today. And as I studied this word in Scripture, and it comes from the Greek and it's translated several different ways. Sometimes it's translated pilgrims, sometimes aliens. But no matter how it's translated, you find something going on in Scripture that is contradictory. And so sometimes people will throw that up and say, see, the Bible contradicts itself. Well, sometimes the Bible calls you aliens and says believers are aliens, but other times it says that you're aliens in a different way, that you're alienated from God. So it says that when Paul wrote to the church in Ephesus, that you were once alienated from God, that is separated from God. Therefore, you were aliens, but now you are believers, that is saints. But on the other hand, we're no longer alienated to God when we're in Christ Jesus. Jesus says we are now aliens in this world because we're followers of Jesus. Here's what Jesus said in John 15. If the world hates you, you know it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love its own. Yet because you are not of this world, but I chose you out of this world, therefore the world hates you. That's what Jesus told us, that we're like aliens in this world and pilgrims. When I first became a Christian, it was a radical transformation for me, not ever going to church and then coming to know the Lord at a church camp at age 15, and then I began to change. I began to memorize Scripture. I began to not listen to so much secular music, and I began to listen to Christian music. And in those days, it was the beginning of Christian rock music. And there was a band that was my favorite band, best Christian band of the 80s, no doubt. It's not even an argument. Petra, which means rock. Anybody ever heard of Petra? Petra, a great band. Well, they wrote a song, it's a classic song, Song of the Year, Not of This World, where they took this verse and they put it into words, and normally Petra rocks out, but this one is a really soft ballad, and I wanted you to hear it, and you ought to hear the rest of it. Would you go ahead and play it, Cameron? The song is about the fact that when you come to know Christ, you are now aliens in this world. This is a theme throughout Scripture when you are God's people. If you look in the Old Testament, you'll see it in 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verse 15, where it says, we are here for a moment, visitors and strangers in the land as our ancestors were before us. Our days on earth are like a shadow, gone so soon without a trace. St. Peter echoed this in the New Testament when St. Peter wrote this to the church. Dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers in this world to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. And so when the Apostle Paul was writing to the church, it was only natural for him to touch on the same theme, which is our verse today. And if you had to summarize that verse into one sentence, I found the perfect sentence. Those who belong to God are aliens in this world, and those who belong to this world are alienated from God. When Paul wrote that to the church at Ephesus, Christians were living in a pagan culture, and they were persecuted, and some were martyred, some were thrown to wild beasts for sport. when you were a Christian in those days, you knew you were going against the culture. Today, I think we find ourselves in a similar situation in many places on the earth. For 300 years, Christianity was really practiced home to home, friend to friend, and Christianity grew like wildfire. And then it was made legal. In 313, the Roman Emperor Constantine issued an executive order called the Edict of Milan. He declared Christianity legal and the religion of the empire. Well, what happened was that this led to something that historians call syncretism. It's where you take biblical Christian values and you mix them and merge them, infuse them with pagan practices. And so that happened. At the same time that happened, Christianity spread all over the world and changed the world. And yet, there's always been this spiritual battle between followers of Christ and the culture, the world, and it continues to this day, and it rages on, and it's going to until Jesus comes back. I'm so glad to be an American. This past year, I was so glad to see Augusto and some of his family become U.S. citizens. They know the blessing of what it means to be an American, but I was born that way. And to learn that the founders of this country founded this nation on Judeo-Christian values. Most of the historic universities and institutions were created by Christian people who wanted to do all the good they could, just like Wesley told us to do. In America, it has been historically comfortable to be a Christian until my generation. Historians now call this generation the postmodern generation, which is kind of humorous because what they mean is post-Christian. The institutions we have today are a far cry from their Christian beginnings. So we have today this battle in our culture, a battle between, and it's a spiritual battle, between two forces. Those that are not of this world, but we're in this world and called to change it, and called to stand up for Christ, and those who are of this world, but they're alienated from God, and their values conflict. That's what we've been experiencing in my lifetime. So what's the difference between cultural Christianity? And by cultural Christianity, I mean exactly what John Wesley defined as the almost Christian in his famous sermon. He said there's a lot of people that are almost Christians. They use the name Christian. They even look like a Christian. They're nice people, but they don't have a burning heart for the Lord. They're not following exactly what the Lord says. So what's the difference between cultural Christianity and biblical historical faith and practice? Well, first, anyone can be a Christian and call themselves a Christian, but not everyone can say that they're living exactly the way Jesus called them to live. In a minute, I'm going to share your story about a man who understood that. The Bible says you are the temple of the Holy Spirit, which means that Christ living in you means you are to be his hands and feet and his voice. There's a renowned atheist named Richard Dawkins. You probably heard of him. He's written a book, The God Delusion, probably his most famous book. But on several occasions, this atheist says he's a cultural Christian. He recognizes the benefits of Christian morality and celebration. He'll call himself a cultural Christian. But he's not a believer. He's not a Christian. Biblical Christianity is nothing less but a commitment to holy living, to living the way Jesus would live if he were walking in your shoes. It means having the mind that was in Christ. That's why Paul wrote, "For who has known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we believers have the mind of Christ." We're to live with that mindset. Anyone can be a cultural Christian. But not everyone who says that they're a Christian is truly living for Jesus. In a minute, I want to tell you about Bill, who will, I think, by his very life, explain that. Secondly, cultural Christianity is comfortable. There's a lot of comfortable Christians. Biblical Christianity is not. It is a real life-changing relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And Cameron, I'm skipping a part, so follow me. I'm just going to go straight to the Bible verse. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 23. That God purchased you at a high price. So don't be enslaved by the world. Understand that cultural Christianity is comfortable. But biblical Christianity is not. You're not supposed to be comfortable as a Christian. You're supposed to live for Jesus. And that's a real life-changing, world-changing relationship. Lastly, cultural Christianity requires little sacrifice. But biblical Christianity requires you to be a living sacrifice for the Lord. It doesn't take much to say you're a Christian, but it takes real faith to live as a Christian in the culture we live in, and especially for our brothers and sisters overseas who live under persecution almost all the time. I had a professor at Asbury Seminary of Evangelism, Dr. Chuck Hunter. Dr. Hunter was a bodybuilder, and though he would lecture us, he would also intentionally go work out at a gym, and he would intentionally engage people in conversations. He would use bodybuilding as a way to then talk about Jesus. He always found a way to do it. Dr. Hunter had a saying, and it's up on the screen for you: Christianity is more caught than taught. What did Dr. Hunter mean by that? He meant that people are watching you live your life. You may never get to say words to a person and tell them about Jesus, but they're watching you. They say, that's what a Christian looks like, by watching you. How you live, that's what they say. Well, that's what a Christian is. Dr. Hunter also meant by this that parents are the number one disciple makers in the world. Jeff, that's his philosophy about Christian ministry. He aims to try to get the parents to understand that their first priority and our first purpose as a church is to get them to make disciples of their own children. That's what Dr. Hunter's talking about. Parents, grandparents, your kids are watching you, and they will define Christianity by how they see you live it out. Christianity is more caught than taught. I was pastor a couple of decades ago of a young man named Bill. He had two little boys in elementary school. And Bill was sort of a nominal Christian, but then something happened in his life. He had a change of heart. And Bill began to realize that what he was living was not truly biblical Christianity. He was just a cultural Christian. And when he realized that, he remembers the day, because his boys started doing the things that he did, and then he saw himself reflected in a mirror. So Bill began to change his life. He cleaned up his language, so he stopped cursing in front of his kids, and he tried to do that everywhere. He cleaned up his life. He began to watch different things on TV. He began to read different books. His interest started changing, and he tried to set an example for his kids. When he had free time, he would spend it with his boys instead of going to do just whatever he wanted to do. Bill changed, and one of the greatest changes he made was that he began to love his wife and honor her in front of his boys and lifted her up like the princess she wanted to be like. I can't believe I didn't get an amen. Are you kidding me? Come on, people. That was one of Bill's greatest changes, because he realized the greatest gift that he could give his kids is a great marriage. And so Bill began to change because he realized that there's a difference between cultural Christianity and really living out what you believe. Christianity is more caught than taught. Cultural Christianity requires very little sacrifice. But biblical Christianity requires that you lay down your life and live for Jesus. How many fathers have ever received a tie on Father's Day? Oh boy, that's becoming a myth now, because and very few men get a tie on Father's Day anymore, but we make fun of it. So I'm wearing my favorite tie today for Father's Day. This tie gets more comments than any tie I wear, and I have some really great ties. I have like Cat in the Hat tie, I've got Snoopy ties. This tie has all the fish swimming one way, but the Christian fish, he's going the other way. The Christian fish is swimming this way. He's swimming against the tide. Did you know that the Greek word for fish is the word ichthys? Up on screen for you is the symbol of the Christian fish. As early as the first century, Christians made an acrostic from the Greek letters, first letters of the words that mean Jesus Christ, Son of God, Savior. Stories are told that when Christians would get together, to be sure they were safe, they would draw the first part of a fish, one arc. And then if the other person they met drew the other part and completed the fish, they knew they were in safe company, because they had to meet in secret. And when they were doing business with people, they wondered who they were doing business with. The fish has been a symbol of the church now from the beginning. Today, some Christians still use the symbol of a fish. Have you ever driven your car and seen a Christian fish on the back of a car? If you do that, please don't be that guy that drives like Jesus is not in the car with you. Sometimes I will confess that is me. And I got to say, Jesus, take the wheel, because this guy just cut me off. When we're going to be a witness for Christ and we're going to wear a Christian fish on the back of the car or on a tie, people are watching us. Listen, if you believe all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, you are swimming against the tide of the culture, because that's not what this culture believes anymore. If you believe in creationism, that God created everything, you're swimming against the tide of the culture. That's not what the culture believes anymore. If you believe life begins at conception, and that life is sacred and holy to God, then you're swimming against the tide of the culture. If you believe marriage is a sacred covenant between one man and one woman, you're swimming against the tide of the culture. If you believe that God has ordained boundaries and placed boundaries about lying and stealing and sexual immorality, you're swimming against the tide of the culture. Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would be fighting. But my kingdom is not of this world." So what kingdom do you belong to? When you came to know Christ as Savior, you were born anew. You were born into Christ, baptized into Christ. When that happened, you were adopted into the family of God. You could then call Him your Father. He called you His child. Who do you belong to? You belong to God our Father. I think the Lord takes great pride in you. I believe when you're living your life well and you're living for Him and giving Him the glory and doing everything you do for the glory of the Lord, I think our Father takes great pride in you, just as an earthly father takes great pride in their children. Don't you love introducing your children? "Oh, this is my child." Unless they're doing something bad, and then it's like, "I don't know this person." You know? But normally, you want to introduce them and you take great pride. "This is my child." Imagine the joy you bring to our Heavenly Father because you live a holy life, swimming against the culture. Those who belong to God are aliens in this world. those who belong to this world are alienated from God. Cameron, put that up one more time. Those who belong to God are aliens in this world. Those who belong to this world are alienated from God. We are strangers. We are aliens. We are not of this world. We're called to go and swim against the tide of the culture and to share the good news of the gospel with those who are alienated from God. Let's pray. Father, I give you thanks today for being able to call you Father. That is so humbling. Forgive us, Lord, where we fall short, where we don't live wholly before you, where we can understand when sometimes you might be embarrassed to call us your children because of things that we do. Lord, forgive us. I pray for my brothers and sisters in Christ today that they might hear the message to swim against the culture, to truly be biblical Christians in the culture we live in, to go and reach those who are alienated from God, even as we once were. But now we know we're just aliens in this strange land till you call us home. Lord, give us your fullness of the Spirit that we might live out what you've called us to be. I pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Let God's church say amen. Amen.
Our closing hymn this morning is number 548. In Christ there is no east or west, in him no south or north, but one great fellowship of love throughout the whole wide earth. Will you stand and let's sing together?
Share just one Bible verse as we end from Philippians chapter 4 verse 7. The peace of God that passes all understanding, guard your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Our mission is to love, witness, and serve.